I'm here today with Katherine from PINK Concussions. She is the founder of PINK Concussions, which has been leading champion for female brain injuries, awareness, research, education, amazing things that have been done. And I'm so excited to have her on Hope Survives podcast for Brain Injury Awareness Month. Welcome, Katherine.
Well, I'm so excited to be here because I've watched your videos over the years and gone, gosh, she's doing so well. I got to try the video. So you have been my inspiration for getting on and presenting. And it really only took me till last year to feel somewhat comfortable. So I've watched a lot of your videos. So you are a great gift to the brain injury community.
Oh, thank you. You're so sweet. I have loved getting to talk to you a lot more, especially over the last month or so. We've been doing some Clubhouse rooms together on the new Clubhouse app and having conversations about brain injury and everything. And I got to meet you. How many years ago was it at DC for the Brain Injury Awareness Day? Was that 2018?
Yeah, because we didn't go 20, or actually, no, I think I skipped out 19 and 20.
19. Okay.
I find it painful. Yeah, so
it might have been 2018 that we met there. I just remember you had the most awesome pink outfit on and like really cool boots.
And I generally always bring pink brain sugar cookies. And if you've ever been to this event, you're in a large marble terrarium for several hours. And by the end, the person with food is the most popular. So.
Well, that's awesome. So, so I'm so excited we're actually sitting down having this conversation today. Of course, female brain injury matters a lot to me as a female brain injury survivor. And I've actually looked at your website and some of your research that you've been doing over the years to learn more about how brain injuries are different in females and males. So would you like to just start out? Let's just start off by talking about PINK Concussions in general, about your organization, what you do, etc. And then we can move into the research and some of the specifics.
Well, thank you. People always ask about my daughters, and I have no daughters. I have three sons, and I was coaching lacrosse, and my son had a concussion from soccer recess, followed up by then a lacrosse concussion. And he had, I think it was 6 concussions in about 13 months. Every 2.5 months, he reconcussed. And it really sort of set our family life on hold. And so I wanted to find out why this was happening. The doctors didn't have any really good ideas. So I actually started going to medical conferences as a mom, because I realized they don't bar the doors. If you want to pay, they'll let go. So I started down that path. I ended up being a concussion educator, and the CDC had put out a bunch of concussion materials, but there wasn't really any way of having to get the materials into the hands of people. So I kind of, in my area, took on that role. And what I noticed is, and more my name got out as kind of like the concussion mom, you know, so I get phone calls. But what I noticed, I was getting phone calls from families of boys, like, we just left the ER, we just came down off the mountains, he hit his head skiing. It was always about, you know, on the way to the hospital, the doctors are on the way home. I mean, it was really within, you know, and then I had a discussion I'd have with them on how their family life would work around that concussion. I was very good at that part because I found that that was left out. What I found with the parents of girls is, it would be, my daughter had a concussion a month ago and she's still out of school. Or my daughter just took 3 exams and she hit her head last week. It was always these stories of girls who were weeks, days, if not weeks or months away from their injury, and they were struggling. And there was some question, someone was questioning either a teacher or a principal or a coach why they weren't better. And this pattern kept continuing. So I sort of thought about it, and I didn't know that many girl parents. We have 3 boys. Not until they're 14 or 15 do girls want to be around them. So I'm like, what's up with these girl parents? Why aren't they taking, like, are they busy? Or are they, did they not get the message? And so only because I was kind of annoyed with them did I start looking at the research. And I found Tracy Kvasson's research you know, pretty right off the bat. And it was from 1999, 2000, 2003, 2005. I mean, it was out there that girls concussed at a higher rate. And then that they had a higher load of symptoms and they felt it more. And there's some argument on this, whether they take longer to heal. We do know that if you look at the population that doesn't heal, there's more women in that group than men. There's men in that group, but in general. So it seemed pretty obvious to me. And this was all pulled together in the American Academy of Sports statement on concussion in 2012. But nobody was talking about it. So I found what I think is a really great brain logo, put it up on a website, and figured if people were interested, it would be there. So that's how PINK Concussion started.
Wow, that's awesome. And that's so funny.
It was going to be a website. I mean, that's all it started out being.
Yeah. So you found this research about how girls had differences in their experience with concussion and in different things like that. So what does PINK Concussions do now? And what role has PINK Concussions played in this?
Well, for the last 2014 was the year that I had survived breast cancer. So I gave myself a present and I went to 14 concussion conferences, which some people thought were kind of crazy. Like, why would you spend a whole year go to concussion conferences? But it's what interests me, you know, I kind of coming out of chemo brain, which was somewhat similar to a concussion, but no pain.
And you also have had concussions yourself, too.
Yes, actually, I had had a number of concussions before my son's concussion, and I kind of realized that people don't really pay attention, nor do they have too much sympathy. So when I have concussions, I would learn to go to the ER. They would really do nothing, charge me $1,200, and then I would go home and have 6 to 8 weeks of headaches. I have repetitive concussions over time. I don't have headaches in between them, but every concussion I've had from a 10 to a 12 week headache. When it ends, the fogginess ends. And then over time, you know, is my ADD getting worse or are the different pieces? I don't know, but I am learning a lot about ADD and dyslexia and where that mixes in with my brain injury over time. So I went to all these conferences and I literally went up to very established people, professionals, either researchers, and I went to Monaco to the IOC International Olympic Committee meeting. I went to, I don't know if that's the year I went to Germany, but I literally went out to, I went as a advocate to concussion conferences and listened and raised my hand and said, you know, your statement that people get better in 7 to 10 days, you said people. And I raised my hand and said, were girls in that study? No, that was actually boys. Oh, because you said people. They're like, oh. So I basically was kind of annoying. So I'd wear a
bright. I love that. You annoyed your way into it.
I annoyed my way with the same party trick. It didn't change. I'm like, were girls and women included in that? And also, you know, I love your study. I noticed that your N was 100 guys. So the pink, the horrendous pink thing, I don't even know where that is. I think I burned it at some point. But the horrendous pink also stood out, especially when I was sort of at a military conference. So people would know I was that
your outfit, woman. You mean?
Yeah, the okay. Pink. Yeah. And I actually wore it at Berlin at the concussion consensus. And there are 400 of us in a room and a guy standing on a table taking a picture of this room. And you can see this like pink blob there. So,
because everyone's in dark colors.
Yeah, I'm always kind of like in dark black. So it was a little bit of a painful moment, but it served its purpose. And it got to the point that people would see me in a room and go, oh, I see Catherine's here. Look, I have women in my studies. So I posed a question, which really wasn't that complicated, multiple times over multiple events to the point where people would come up and apologize that they had only looked at men. So
let me just recap. For years of concussion and brain injury research, only boys and men were studied.
They did not study females. They studied. So originally it was studied, if you go back in the history, and the history is fascinating, but let's just go back, you know, 100 years, the brain injury study was around railroad accidents. industrial accidents. And then you have World War One, where you have PTSD is described as shell-shocked, and but a lot of the soldiers died before they got off the field to have brain injury. World War II, Vietnam, each successive war, we got better at bringing people off the battlefield. They survived longer, but then they ended up having brain injuries. And then, so that was the research was mostly for the military. So in general, that was, you know, there are nurses, there were women that were killed in combat injury, but mostly it's men studying men. When we shifted to boxing, again, mostly men studying men. And then when the industry really picked up on studying brain injury, they're like, where are we going to find brain injury? Well, you could wait on the, you know, highway ramp, or you could go to a football field. It's a perfect laboratory. So I have a quote from this Dr. Schneider in 1967. He said, the football fields of America are basically the lab for brain injury research. So they knew where to find brain injury. So that's why.
And they knew what it was doing to the players.
Right. So the brain injury doctors went to the field to study the players because it's in poor taste to bring people into your lab and hit them on the head. So you have to find brain injury. So that's where it's a cyclical problem.
Okay.
Essentially with football, because if you're a football doctor, you're supporting the game, but you're also finding the damage, but you can't speak out too much about the damage because you don't want to damage the reputation of the game. So they got in a spin cycle there. In the laboratory, when they had female animals, the menstrual cycle of the rats and mice, which is about 6 days, it's a pretty fast cycle, would throw off the results. So they knew that there was something about the hormones in the menstrual cycle that threw off the experiment. And they're like, wow, this just is creating a mess of our data. We'll simplify things and throw the females out. Now, today, that's called sex as a biological variable. Sex as a B, so it's S, I'm dyslexic, S-A-B-V, SABA. So SABA is now a data element, and it's something that researchers can go and actually ask for money for and get SABA grants to study sex as a biological variable. And currently at NIH, you have to have women in your study or have a really good argument why you don't for the research to go in and be funded. You don't have to report on sex differences on the way out the other side. So I'd like to change that.
Okay. Wow. So when you were talking about the studies on rats and the way that the menstrual cycle affected it. So their thing was, well, we just don't want to deal with that variable, so we just won't study it.
Yeah, it was a speed bump. It was a speed bump in their way. So they just work on male animals. Now, at some point, you know, in the beginning, maybe the science was so new and, you know, it's men studying an injury at the time. It was reported, it's more reported in men than women. And as Willie Stewart says, because men do more daft things, men take more risks, they drive faster, they have more access to firearms, you know, they tend to be wilder. I'm a wild female, so I ran with the boys. Men used to drink more. A sad fact is that women are now drinking as much as men. So whether that brain injury shifts a little more male and female, as women drink more alcohol. But in general, they're like, this is a male problem. We're all guys. We're studying football players. So we were kind of left out of the conversation.
Yeah. So how has there been strides in research of women? So you explained like how in some of the studies you were like, hey, are you even talking about women? But what are some of the strides that have been made in brain injury research about females, and what are some of the findings?
Well, Tracy Kvasson was really the first, and she was up in Canada and loved hockey and studied hockey. And her thought was, there are all these male studies, I wonder about female studies. So she got the NCAA data and she looked, and with sports with the same rules, so soccer to soccer, and if you're in Europe, your football, but our soccer to soccer, males to females, if it's the same rules, they found that the rate of women is higher. There are more women that will concuss than men. If it's even if it's a game like hockey where women don't check and men do check, the rates are almost higher too in women in that one too, even though that there's not checking. But in general, it has to be the same rules, which means risk, because in general, if you have a bunch of men and a bunch of women, men will be the first ones, you know, trying to figure out if they can jump from the roof onto the pool, you know, and not that there aren't a couple of crazy chicks like me following behind, but in general, you know,
yeah,
the boys are going to be a little more creative when they're fun. And
I like how you use the word creative. That was creative. That's a nicer word than what I was thinking. So let's go with that.
I remember walking out once with my boys and my son asked to use the blender and I was like, what? And he's like, oh, we need a motor. I'm like, what? And he had taken the blender, taken the glass part off and had the blade. And they were trying to figure out if they could attach it to something to like make a speedboat. And I'm like, no, they had life jackets on. I mean, they were ready to go, you know?
Oh my goodness. Wow.
So, it involves a sled, you know, so the creativity, and that's not to say that there aren't
excuse
women.
The data was what you're saying though, because men are more likely to engage in risky behavior. So maybe they're going to get more concussions in general, but the rate, if you look at the percentage, women actually get concussions more in like a same, if you could study the same situation, for example.
But there was no picture of that. So what I've been waiting for, and I have a slide when I talk about this, like I grew up with, here is a lung on, if you smoke, your lungs will look like this, you know, and I was like horrified. It obviously didn't work with the Juul generation, but I was pretty horrified. So I was looking for that picture and there wasn't a picture at the time. So it was tended to be, well, that's because women are more expressive about their pain. And there was a study, a cardiac study that said women were more expressive about their pain. And that got rolled into a lot of abstracts without the source being put there. But if you go back to women report more, we may be more articulate about our pain. You know, men can grunt and we'll be like, oh, it's, you know, a slight pain in the back of my, you know, so there's an expressive ability I think women have to discuss pain, but I don't think we are more wimpy, more willing to whatever. And so if you have a male culture, male sports, and women go into that, and then there's more women's injury, then you could say, well, I think the women are more likely to report.
So like,
a lot of the times
people could say, it's only because women, they wimpy, to use a word, but it's only because women are more likely to explain how they feel.
Yeah. And they jumped on that study, that cardiac study that said women report more without actually reading it. And you have to go back because for the last, I don't know, 10 years, people haven't footnoted it because once a fact becomes like such a fact, you know, we breathe oxygen. You don't, if you put that in the abstract of your paper, you don't have to footnote it because it's just fact. So it took me a while to go back into papers to find that reference, to find the study, to see where it goes. And that's where the kind of the historian part of me. So that one's been a big
really
one.
Smart.
Right. So Doug Smith and Willie Stewart was a part of this, and it was a Penn State study. I think it was published 2018 or 19. Those years are merged right now for me, but it actually showed a picture of, you take a male's brain and a female's brain. And I can give you a graphic if you want to put up for, and then you go down to the smallest denominator, which is a nanotubular, and you look at those cells. And the women's have, if it's like a bunch of string inside a tube, the women have fewer strings and they're more slender. The men, it's heavier and thicker, like a heavier, thicker rope. So,
yeah, I want to see that graphic. Definitely send that over.
See if I have it. So, I don't think I have that actually. I have it actually off on my computer, so
no
I can
problem.
Put it up. So you can
just send it over.
So we have a lot of cartoons where the brain goes, you know, bung, 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 bung. And again, I want to also say I'm a social worker. I'm a social worker. I've published research. I'm not a doctor. people think of the brain like bouncing around inside, where actually it sort of torques and turns. And I think it's like it's some tiny little fraction it actually moves, but it's more like this twerking. Well, at the lowest level, you have these strands that are moving past each other when that torque happens. And the more slender ones tend to break more. So there's more breakage on the phenyl ones. And when that breaks, there's a change in the ions. So you kind of get a little bit of a nasty soup.
So there's actually structural difference in a female's brain versus a male's.
And they see it in mice and humans. And I've been waiting for this. So we could stop this. Well, women are just whatever women are.
They're just wimpy or whatever. Same. Yeah.
Yeah. It's because, I talked right when I started Pink Concussions in 2012, I happened to go to a meeting where I thought I was representing my state or maybe even my county. And I went to DC to present on youth sports concussion and families. And I was representing the United States, which I had no idea until I got there. And in front of me was the US Army athletic trainer for West Point. And he went through his whole slide deck on people. And then he said, I have a slide. I just don't know where to put it. So I'm just gonna put it up here. My cadets at West Point take the female cadets sometimes take twice as long to the male cadets to come back to sports. And I don't really know why, but I see this. Does anyone else see this? And the Navy was also presenting and they were seeing it too. So
so there's a reason that this is happening. There's a reason that females who have brain injuries have these prolonged symptoms, or it might present like maybe they're more likely to get a concussion in the first place, or maybe it takes longer.
Well, and this paper, I think it's 2018, this paper that came out was the first time they'd ever seen it. So, and that's the thing I think
we have to tangibly through the data.
Yeah. Well, we have a picture. Like there's literally
so recent, 2018.
Right.
Like, so this is just a couple years ago.
We are in the infancy. And I've been waiting around for this picture to show up, right? I've been hanging out with the imaging people going, can you get a picture of this? And they're like, not yet. So we've just identified it. It's like, it's like you find dinosaur bones in the sand. You're like, oh, we just found something. They haven't even pulled it out of the sand and figured out how it's put together or the history either way. We just found the thing. So we found
there's something there.
Right. Now, there's also work at the same time where you have Christine Master, who I love, Dr. Master, mom, doctor at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, CHOP. And they did a study, and a pediatric study, and they're looking at kids going to the ER. So there was a study a number of years ago that was done by the Osteopath Society, that they were asking about. They did a phone survey and said, and what they came out is that if you fell in the backyard as a kid, you had about a 50-50 chance of your parent taking you into the doctors. If you had a head injury, brain injury in a field of play, like playing sports, you had about an 80% chance. So that if your brain injury, if your suspected brain injury is in a public area, you go down, people see you, people are asking your parents, they're more likely to take you in than if you came in and said, I just fell out of a tree on my head, when you get handed an ice pack. So not everybody is brought to care. There are differences, right? There are cultural differences, financial differences, where you're going. So they looked at the study of ER. So this isn't a perfect study because not everybody ends up in the ER. But what they found is between the girls and the boys, they found the girls took about a week long. I think it was like a week longer than the boys to recover. But when they looked back, they saw that the girls were brought in a week later than the boys. So that there was a perspective of the parents, which is what I had seen, is that the parents weren't bringing the girls in for treatment. So until we clear up, there's the definitely biological sex differences. And then there's also cultural gender differences of how we treat girls and how we bring girls in for treatment. And when you get there, how the doctors may treat a girl. So I'll never say it's all biological or it's all how we treat. It's a combination.
Yeah.
How often do we have athletic trainers at girls' events? The recent NCAA study did not see differences in Division I males and females athletes, but they did at the third division, where they didn't have athletic trainers because there isn't equal medical care for men and women. Okay. So it'll be interesting to see over time. And that's why I find it so exciting, because what I talk about today is different than what I talked about 2 years ago. It's different than 2 years from that. We are at the beginning of brain injury study. We're way behind a lot of the other neurological groups like Alzheimer's and some of the bigger, more funded ones. Autism, but we're catching up and we've got imaging now to show some of this stuff. So I find it exciting.
Yeah, that's awesome. You know, when you were saying that maybe like girls are treated differently, there was a neurologist early on that when my mom was saying, hey, like my daughter is really struggling, like she's not able to do this, she's not able to do that. She was like, well, she's, you know, she's struggling in her, like she can't do her schoolwork. And I was like, a really, really academically advanced before. Like I was what they call a nerd. I was made fun of in elementary school. Like I was four eyes, glasses girl. I was like, I love to read. I was ahead of grade in school. I was very, very nerdy. Math was easy for me. Afterwards, I could not do simple addition. Like I couldn't add. And she was saying to the doctor, like, hey, she's not able to add. Like she's really struggling in that. And he said, well, she's a girl. She doesn't need to know math anyway. That was literally what he said. Yeah. She's a girl. She doesn't need to know math anyway. But then when he would do the F test, like where you have to say all the words that start with the letter F, I could only think of like one.
Right.
Like, and so, but he didn't care. And so how many more girls are experiencing this type of thing that they think the girls are just, you know, whatever, they're fine, they're being dramatic, etc. There was one doctor that said that I was depressed or anxious and that I was just like tired because I was just like depressed, you know.
Well, and there's that, you know, well, she was a little wonky before the head injury. So, and I've seen that too. And I've seen that in male doctors that I actually really like.
Yeah.
And I'm like, come on.
The doctor that said that I was probably just depressed was a female doctor. So, right. I mean, you never really know, but in the sense of like, you know, and that might be, we might be stepping out of just talking about female concussions in general. The whole invisible thing is a struggle. Now, this was over 10 years ago when I was having these experiences. So I hope the medical community has made advances in the last decade. But going back to when you were talking about like the female versus male research and how new that is there any like bullet points or things that you can share as far as, hey, this is what we know about female concussions. This is how they're different and just kind of like in a nutshell, some of the differences.
A little nutshell. As a social worker and a non-doctor, this is the way I've taken science and made it very layman. But imagine a male's brain is wired electrically like a 6-lane highway. And there are all these lanes and there's cars going down the highway. If a car breaks down in any of those lanes, it blocks that lane, right? But then cars can go on either side of it because there's different lanes to shift to. The way a female brain is wired electronically is more globally, and they describe that more like a city block. So if a car breaks in the middle of an intersection in that city, it's going to cause gridlock in that section and spread out and cause gridlock in a way. So that is a thought to try to compare how whether same brain injury, same amount of damage would cause more of a global issue with women than with men that can shift to another lane. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so it's literally the way that the brain is structured that is different.
We don't know over time which is more neuroprotective. Maybe that's, we could just be superior in that way. You know, maybe we have a slow recovery, but maybe over a 30 or 40 year period, is just making this up, but maybe we have a slower recovery because we're repairing ourselves correctly and they repair themselves, their brains too quickly, and they go back out.
But we do have a slower recovery. We know that.
Well, there's some arguments. I mean, there's definitely some arguments because women aren't given equal medical care. What we need to do is give women equal medical care, equal access to getting to the doctor on time, equal access treatment, equal access rehab, and then see on the other side.
I would even say then, because women aren't getting that and women, it is taking women longer, maybe it's not, maybe it's a combination of it being structural and also societal in the fact that women are treated differently or women don't get care as sooner or it's not taken as seriously in a lot of ways.
We do know that women are less likely to have inpatient rehab care. And it's also true, I was talking to in the military, because women tend to be caregivers. So even if you have a brain injury and are offered a 3-week rehab, you're taking care of your grandmother, your mother, and your kid, and you can't get away to do that. So they're like, okay, we'll offer you 2 weekends, 6 weeks apart. So this isn't, we've seen this in COVID too. How many women have the gig job without the insurance? They're taking care of 3 people are the most vulnerable, and they're the frontline workers, and they don't have insurance. And then issues of racism, systemic racism, you know, like the most vulnerable end up the most vulnerable because they're the most vulnerable, you know?
Wow.
So,
yeah.
And we've seen that in COVID too. How many women are on the front lines with the least amount of protections? Mm-hmm. So I think women's healthcare in general, that's where we struggle, because we're going to take that part-time job because we're taking care of the kids and we're not going to have the health insurance we need, nor the authority to say, I'm going to take the next 3 weeks off to take care of myself.
Wow. Yeah, that makes sense.
So we've just identified these differences, right? What we don't know is over time, what are these differences? I just described a kind of a negative scenario, right? That there's breakage and there's this ion soup and it looks like there's more vulnerability. But what if over time, that's actually neuroprotective and that's how it's supposed to break down and it somehow goes back together and we have less of a long-term effect of brain injury than men? Like, we don't know. All we know is this snapshot moment. So even though I described it as a vulnerability, maybe that's a good thing. Like, we don't know.
So because we don't have, there's just, so what I'm hearing is there's just not enough research.
We are in the infancy of this. I mean, in the neurology field, brain injury has always been the ugly little stepchild. We were not invited to the party. We were like, oh, those brain injury people. So that's just scientists in general. You know, I went to a CTE event at NIH where they're trying to figure out CTE grades like 1, 2, 3, 4. And there are people out there that are like, this is a grade 3 or this is a grade 4. Well, I sat in a room of scientists and they couldn't agree that that's the scale. So they were talking about CTE and that CTE in the first paper was it could be this, glial cells, or, and I can't remember what the second thing is. They did it was it could be this or this. And they all talked in the room and they're like, this isn't really working out very well. That or should have been the and. And they're like, yeah, we're going to write another paper. So they were changing the definition while I was sitting there. And I was kind of there of an observer and I was there to raise my hand and said, and what about women? Which is why I get invited to things a lot to go, and what about women? That's kind of like my, and again, the party trick isn't any different than I was doing 10 years ago. It's the same thing. But, there's so much more to come. And I'm a social worker and I've given presentations at the VA, at the US Army in Landstuhl in Germany, I've trained doctor. I mean, like, I'm a social worker. Okay. So I don't think that I could do this in the field of, you know, pick another organ, liver or hearts, you know, like, mm-hmm. Body, the organism that I'm, the organ that I'm describing, the brain, they basically had to throw out a lot of stuff of what they had learned to start again. And it doesn't translate. Basically, everything we can do on mice, all the medications that work on mice, 0% of it transfers to humans. So it's like they can cure mice of anything. They can do anything with a mouse, but it doesn't extrapolate to humans. So not only do we have to take the mice research, but we have to have a middle animal and learn how to do brain injury repair and rehab with that animal, then move to humans. So we're, you know, they got the mice down, but we got a lot of other ways to go. So I think it's exciting. I see so much potential, and I'm excited that as this research is taking off, that women will be included in it now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just to even be in the studies.
Yeah. We haven't missed a lot, honestly. Now looking back, I feel like they missed us, but now that we're here and now that we're at a new level and a new sophistication, we have to make sure that even though women are in studies, that they are being studied as women. And this is a little argument with the NCAA Grand Alliance study, is that women are in that and getting the same tests and treatment and MRIs that the males are, which is great. Like, they're being equals, but I want them to have additional hormonal testing. And when I discussed that with them, they were like, that's too many points. That's too difficult. We'll get to it later. So I'm kind of like, okay. So I'm kind of annoying on that extent, because I think we should be studied as women.
Yeah. Sorry. Can you say that again?
Oh, so I think we should be studied as women, as opposed to the hormones and the hormone cycles that are unique to us.
Yeah, that's great. And I'd actually heard of this one study. I forget what conference I was at, but somebody was presenting and they were talking about studies in rats with the hormonal changes and how it affected the brain, something about the brain. And so that was like, I was like, whoa, like, and I wonder if like for a woman, like where they are in their cycle when they have their brain injury and how that affects the brain, the concussion and the effects, like there has to be something there, because the fact that brain injuries can affect your hormones. Like I'm going to just share candidly my experience as a woman. When I had my brain injury, my cycle was thrown off, like completely thrown off, like crazy. Like it was so irregular. And before the brain injury happened, it was like clockwork. And afterwards it was super irregular, and I've gotten re-injured, and like over time, like it started to get better. It started to get more regular again. And when I got another concussion, my cycle was completely irregular again. It would be like 6 weeks, 3 weeks, 2 weeks. Like it was like, it always came, but it never came like it should have. And over time, it's kind of evened itself out naturally. But there has to be some sort of research that needs to be done about like the way that the hormones and the brain are interconnected.
And they very are much connected. I know that I have ADD, and when I take better plug in, hold on a second. I'm ADD. And those of us that are ADD know that during our cycle, I can take ADD meds and be, you know, on it. During the first couple of days of my periods, it's like my ADD medication doesn't work. A hormone flood that actually is your body going through that cycle takes over. So in the same way, a brain injury definitely affects the hormones. They know this in men, and the U.S. Army or the VA, when after someone with a moderate to severe TBI male, they wait a year and they do a male hormone panel because they know it'll take about a year for the hormones to settle down. So any takeaway, I think that every woman, girl that has a brain injury should definitely check in with the gynecologist and have the gynecologist aware of that. And if there's a cool thing about an endocrine issue is that they're treatable. So if it's particular, you're low in something, you can take hormone replacement, mm-hmm. you're high in something, like they can, it's actually the part of brain injury that they can work on. So I think it's a very positive.
I just wonder how many gynecologists even know about brain injuries. Like that should because there isn't much research about it, hopefully in the future, like they're being trained to know that concussions or brain injuries could affect it, but it might not even be in their training.
there's an article. This is the magazine, Brain Injury Professional Magazine. And there's an article, a study in Arizona that I recently did a Zoom show on, that a high percentage of female adolescents after brain injury in this study in Arizona had endocrine problems. Wow. So there's definitely research out there. And it's just, you know, with everything else, you know, if you're going to the doctor and you're doing all of this stuff, do you really want to go to the gynecologist on top of it? And you may feel like, you know, you may not know that that's an area where you can actually take a medication that can help those particular symptoms. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really important. And how many sports doctors, you know, ask about one's period? I mean, we have one doctor who got up on the stage and, you know, he said something about, it was talking about the menstrual cycle. And then I had another woman speaker after him who went really in depth into the menstrual cycle. And he looked at me, he came to me, he's like, why did you have me speak? She was, you know, and I'm like, cause you're a male. When we say menstrual cycle, men hear, but you as a male standing in front of males saying menstrual cycle helps get the message across. And honestly, if you went up on the stage and said menstrual cycle three times, you know, I'm already ahead on the game right there. You know, men that's need to so talk funny. To other men about menstrual cycle, you know?
Yeah.
So,
yeah, that's good.
But the nice area is that we don't know all of this stuff that's different, maybe things in the long run that are neuroprotective. Mm-hmm. So we're just at the infancy of this, and there's nothing here that damns men or women, you know, to never recover. And I don't believe that you get stuck forever in any one place. You know, we're always growing. I think we're always learning and expanding our brains. And I think it's exciting because new stuff's going to come out.
Yeah, that's so good. And like you said, we're still learning. We're still growing. I read something about how women's neck muscles being weaker could potentially cause more concussions or whiplash just because of the smaller necks. So like, you know, there's so many factors that are out there that need to be addressed and studied. And thank you, Katherine, for your work in championing female brain injury and getting it out there through PINK Concussions. And thank you for coming on the podcast today. Are there any last, you know, tidbits or encouragement or any last words you'd like to share before we go?
Well, I'm having so much fun. I have to wrap it all up. I just that, you know, if a grandmother falls, if your mother falls, your sister, your daughter, you know, just take a little extra care. It may not look like a concussion that you've seen in a guy. Their symptoms may pop up later. It just may not be the same. And if they're not getting better, get them to medical care. And if they're not better, find somebody that will treat them with sex and gender specific care and support. We're not really that great at supporting people with brain injury, men or male or female. So, and I think that's the community that you've built, is so important because that support really makes a difference. You know, we can't cure brain injury right now, but we can build communities and support each other and share the love and like share your music and, all the stuff that you're doing. So I'm excited. I mean, I think we sound like Clubhouse, pitches here, but I'm really excited about what we're building in Clubhouse. Now we're building a community there that's a lot more interesting to talk to somebody and accessible than a monthly Zoom call. And I'm excited.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Katherine. This has been amazing. I'm going to put your links in the description for the PINK Concussion website and your social medias and all that so people can get in touch with you if they want to connect. So thank you for coming on the podcast.
Thank you. And I look forward. We're having an event in July, which I am excited to have you share your music. So
yeah, I can't wait.
I'm excited for that.
Come and sing. It'll be so fun. So virtual event for it's everyone.
It's the IBIA World Brain Congress. And the event's Pink X, because it's our 10th one. So you'll be our featured singer for that event.
I can't wait. Thank you so much.
Take care.